Hi, LA Progressive fans and friends. We're honored today to have Henry Giroux, a distinguished professor at McMaster University, the McMaster University Chair for Scholarship in the Public Interest. Among his recent books are Insurrections, Education, and the Age of Counter-Revolutionary Politics. We're going to talk about an article that he recently honored us by letting us publish, Corporate Media in the Age of Fascist Politics, Firewalls of Ignorance and Disappearance. It's so nice to meet you finally, Henry, this way. We've communicated endless times on email, and it's such a delight that you allow us to republish your work. Thank you, sir.
Well, it's not a matter of being honored. I feel honored. I think LA Progressive is probably such an such an important outlet, and one of the few outlets, it seems to me, that really embraces the truth in a rather untarnished way in the service of economic and political justice.
Absolutely. I so thank you for acknowledging that and for appreciating. I mean, the LA Progressive is sort of our child. Dick and I have been spending every day with the LA Progressive for almost 17 years. And so it's really a reflection of our thoughts and the hopes and the dreams of the writers that so graciously allow us to republish them. I'm still feeling a little bit awful because yesterday there was an election, a primary election in New York, where I'm originally from the Bronx, Eden Wall Projects in the Bronx. And the person who would have been my congressional representative if I was still living there would have been Jamal Bowman. And Jamal Bowman, he was the incumbent, and he was ousted by someone who was heavily funded by AIPAC. And, you know, I listen to I read your pieces and listen to your words, and I think, oh, why can't the masses have this level of understanding? Henry, you have done so much research, so much writing, have attempted to share this knowledge, and yet we get these terrible outcomes. How do you deal with that?
Well, I think that one of the things that we have to recognize that is that under neoliberal capitalism, we find ourselves in a position where civic culture is collapsing. And we're not just experiencing, in some ways, a politics driven by money, which has been going on for a long time, but we're experiencing a politics that basically is rooted increasingly in a form of historical and social and political amnesia that suggests that we're operating at a new level of politics. And that is, we've come to realize, I think, that economic domination is not the only mode of domination, that the realm of the symbolic, the realm of persuasion, the realm of beliefs have taken on a currency in this merging of power, politics, and technology that we've never seen before. And so I think that what we're talking about is a crisis of civic literacy. We're talking about a collapse of education. And when I say that, I don't mean education simply as schooling. I mean a notion of education that is absolutely central to politics itself. This is a fight over ideas. It's a fight over mass consciousness. It's a fight over identity. And the right knows this. They've known it since the Powell Memo of 1971. They're very clear about this stuff. They have foundations. They pump money into controlling into the corporate media. And all of that is used to basically produce what we call, and what I've often written for you, is a form of manufactured ignorance. We live in the age of disimagination machines. And all I'm really saying here is the alternative media, like LA Progressive, which is one of the finest in my mind, has taken up that challenge. And the left has got to take up this challenge. They've got to talk to people in a way in which they can recognize themselves. We've got to bring back a politics of emotion. We've got to address what it means for people to be alienated and lonely and not have a language other than the language of hatred, cynicism, systemic racism, Christian nationalism, that gives them an opportunity to imagine a future in which hope is visceral. They can feel it, and they can feel it not just individually, but feel it collectively.
So your current article and elsewhere talks about the rise of fascism, as you just did, and the failure of mainstream media to effectively call it out. Yeah. Why do you think that is?
Well, I think that mainstream media is really a logic of capitalist politics. I mean, let's not fool ourselves. You can't talk about fascism, as Brexit, without talking about capitalism. We're in the age of global capitalism. I mean, I don't think that they're going to print stuff that in some way says, hey, look, one of the great scourges of the world today and that fuels militarism and climate destruction and everything else is inequality, massive degrees of inequality. They're not going to do that. They're not going to say that militarism is central to what America has been about for the last 200 years. They're not going to do that. I mean, what they're going to do is attempt to normalize those elements of discourse and speech and persuasion that seem to suggest that these problems are not systemic, that they're private issues. You know, they're small issues that we can just move the checkers around in a way in order to solve that. I mean, they have a real interest in not attacking, they have a real interest in covering over those arguments that would expose the enormous systemic inequities at work in the system. They're not going to do that. No. Their goal is to both entertain, to make profits, and to essentially normalize the worst systemic parts of the system. But they do that because they have the power to depoliticize. These are massive depoliticizing machines, and they do it by normalizing issues like this last election. Come on. It's not a primary between two different liberals. It's a primary in which one guy is on the side of democracy, Jamal. The other guy is on the side of fascism and militarism and slaughter. Let's use the right language.
Right.
The language has been so watered down and so whitewashed that you have to really understand it as part of a larger project. You cannot talk about what the media is doing without at the same time, for instance, not talking about the banning of books.
Right.
Or not talking about the attack on trans people, or talking about the attempt to basically whitewash history again and make it clear that the only people who really deserve citizenship are white Christian nationalists. This is all part of, it seems to me, a much larger project. And we fail often by not bringing these pieces together and understanding them in a more comprehensive, larger project. And that's the responsibility of the press.
Yeah.
And what I did with the argument that the paper I sent to you was, I wanted to highlight something fundamental that I didn't quite put in the paper strongly enough. Mainstream media, not to mention the right-wing media, is on the side of ethicide. It's on the side of the death of ethics. That's what ethicide is. And what I mean by that is that they model a neoliberal logic that says economic activity is divorced from social cost. So we don't have to think about the consequences to people's lives, just as they don't have to think about the consequences, the New York Times, for instance, for urging their reporters not to use the word slaughter,
right,
or not to use words that would be indicative of the enormous, massive suffering and the causes of that suffering by two right-wing governments. They cover it over. That's ethicide. That's about the death of moral witnessing and the death of moral responsibility. That's one of the crises we face.
So it seems to me that these people aren't stupid. The decisions that they're making at their own peril, because ultimately the harms that are going to be done are global. I mean, when we look at the global climate change, do you think that they somehow believe that they can walk this tightrope and come out okay?
Sharon, honestly, it's a fabulous question. And it's a question that is motivated by a sense of hope and justice. But I have to tell you, they believe in short-term goals. They don't believe in long-term goals. These are the same people who are building bunkers somewhere on some island 400 miles away from the United States and believing if there's a nuclear war or there's a global catastrophe, it won't affect them. They don't think in terms of social responsibility. I don't want to be crude, but they think in terms of commodities. They think in terms of profits. They think in terms of massive investments. And I'll give you the most powerful indicator of that. You can judge the state of democracy in any society by how it treats its children.
Right.
Because that's an investment in the future. Children are relatively helpless. So you have to make social investments. This country has so failed its children, particularly Black, Brown, white working class kids, in ways that reveal that they're no longer seen as a long-term investment. They're seen as a short-term investment. That logic, Dick and Sharon, drives everything the mainstream press does. What's it concerned about? Spectacles, entertainment, endless articles about how Trump is too old. You know, nonsense. I mean, it's nothing more than the simulacrum on steroids. That's exactly what it is. And certainly the Washington Post or the New York Times will publish a piece that's an expose that suggests some kind of investigative reporting at work, but it never goes to the heart of the problem. This is all ice cream on the top of the cake. It never does something that's so systemic as to be able to say, okay, we're at our limits with capitalism. It doesn't work. Neoliberalism doesn't work. How are we going to rethink the future in terms of a democracy that is not simply defined by market values, but is defined instead by human and social needs?
So I just want to just ask a quick question based on the news. Two things happened in the news yesterday. Julian Assange pled guilty and time served 62 months. My question, I don't know if you've done any analysis on the whole Julian Assange matter, but I have often wondered why it is that Joe Biden picked up this case when Barack Obama wouldn't. Barack Obama, famously labeled it the New York Times problem, because what Julian Assange did as a journalist was also done by other large outlets. Nobody talks about the New York Times, but they also published the same information that Julian Assange published. So I've been trying to figure out, why is it that Joe Biden did what he did? And why is it that he's accepting this plea now? Does he think that it's going to give him a bump up in the November election?
I don't know. I think in some way, Sharon, I may be terribly wrong on this. You know, Biden has so damaged the youth vote over Gaza, that I think he's making small inroads and trying and making small attempts in some ways to garner back that vote, right? You know, more defaulting on student loans, erasing small student loans. And when I read that, that's what I thought. I thought this was an appeal to the freedom of the press that in some way might ameliorate the concerns that, for instance, young people have over the fact that freedom of speech, particularly on campuses, academic freedom has now become a matter of police repression. So I don't know what I mean. Certainly, Trump will go after this in some way, as that really scurrilous Mike Pence did, by claiming that he should be put in jail forever. You know, the Assange. So I think in some way it's an attempt to play to the youth vote. That's what I think.
So another piece of this, of your article and your conversation, is the normalization of Donald Trump by the mainstream media. Yes, the more liberal press mocks him, ridicules him, but they don't really delve into the damage he can do. Rather, they use him as entertainment value. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's because the deeply wealthy and their handlers in the mainstream media aren't going to be harmed no matter who's president. They floated along through the Trump years. Yes, common everyday people and people around the world are going to be damaged, but not so much them.
I'm not sure what the question is, Dick. Is the question billionaires? Why are billionaires supporting Trump, or is it? That they don't really care who wins, because in the long run they're going to come out benefiting anyways?
Well, I think that is a part of what I was saying. I think that the wealthy don't really care one way or another because they'll stay in charge. But I was more focused on why doesn't the media really focus on the fact that the things that Donald Trump says and proposes are deeply damaging. They're not just a counterpoint to Joe Biden's arguments.
Let me give you an explanation for that I hope is clear. I mean, look, in order to understand the role that billionaires are now playing in this election, you have to understand that the system that they're a part of has lost its legitimacy. It's in crisis. It can't justify itself any longer by saying, all boats will rise in the river. There'll be social mobility. People will get jobs. It doesn't do that anymore. So it's moved to the right and embraced a fascist logic in which it says, well, if there are problems with the system, it's not because of capitalism. It's basically because of Blacks, of immigrants. It's basically because of brown people. It's basically because there are people who are basically destroying the system, and they don't really care in some fundamental way about what democracy means. And they're also potentially violent criminals, right? So this logic means to me that the ultra right, not the ultra right, the financial elite in some way now no longer in a position to say, we think government should work in the interest of democracy. What they now say boldly is government should only work in the interest of markets and should only work in the interest of economics. So I slightly disagree with the assumption that they don't care. They care because they want Trump to win. I think they don't like his tariffs. There are policies they don't like, but Trump will protect them. Trump will keep the masses suppressed. Trump will make sure that immigrants are deported, that concentration camps are established. In other words, he'll do everything he can, not through ideological persuasion, but basically through the force of law to keep that system in place. And the system is in crisis. So they're not going to side with Biden. Some of them are. Some of them might have some sense of social justice. Some of them might recognize that tariffs are going to destroy the economy in terms of what Trump is talking about in terms of his economic policies. But remember, these are political animals. They're about power. You know, they're not about balance and seeing normality. They want the system in some way to thrive and to keep the threats in place. And I think that what they saw with respect to the campus uprising, the encampments, was something that terrified them, because it seemed to suggest that young people all over the country no longer accepting this neoliberal logic are no longer accepting the notion that public goods are really private goods that should serve the interests of the rich and the billionaire class. When you look at people like Ackman, you know, who was a liberal, this guy was a liberal, and all of a sudden now he's one of these powerful forces pushing the elite universities to really become nothing more than indoctrination centers for white supremacy and for militarism. I mean, they're the model that we need to focus on. I mean, if there are others saying, you know, like Bill Gates saying, you know, yeah, I think Trump is a threat, I don't see them as the driving force of that financial elite. I think they're marginal people in that struggle. And so it seems to me that I'm more concerned about what that billionaire class can do to legitimate and usher in through Trump a form of fascism. And I don't use that word lightly. This is fascism. You know, and we can talk about that later, but it seems to me they're on the side of protecting capitalism by finally realizing it can no longer legitimate itself. It's in crisis, and they're going to go where Trump is going. That's where they're going to go. That's my analysis of that.
Yeah, that's my concern as well. And it's, and you know, belonging to a marginalized group already as a woman, being Black and now older, it's really frightening. So you said you wanted to talk a little bit about fascism. Why don't you talk to our audience? The LA Progressive has, I would say, a very sophisticated group of readers, but there are also people who are young, who don't always understand this language. Talk to them about what you mean by fascism.
I think when we talk about fascism, we have to do two things. We have to recognize the old fascism versus the new fascism. And I think the old fascism was really organized around concentrating power in the interest of both militarism and racial cleansing, operating off the assumption that basically white racial groups had a certain kind of superiority, which demanded that it be incorporated into a limited notion of citizenship, exercised through repression. And the endpoint of that repression, of course, was the concentration camp. It seems to me the new fascism does something else. The new fascism operates off a politics of disposability, as anti-intellectual in the worst possible sense, like the old fascism was. It represses dissent. It operates in such a way as to deal with binaries. It says that you have a friend-enemy distinction in which anybody who's a critic is the enemy, and enemies need to be extinguished, eliminated. It operates for a form of government, and this is really one of the most important elements of the new fascism. It operates by claiming that government should have nothing to do with democracy, that democracy is illiberal. The old fascism said, this is fascism in the interest of democracy, right? Yeah. The new fascism says, democracy is awful, it's illiberal, as Orban says in Hungary, their model, right? That we need an illiberal democracy. We need to be upfront about authoritarianism as being the best form of government because, while it may suppress your rights, don't worry. Mm-hmm. It at least provides some security. And it'll keep the blacks out, the browns out, the immigrants, the refugees. In other words, the domestic space will not be contaminated by the viruses, the poisoning of the blood, all that sort of thing that they've inherited from the old fascism, but now we're very upfront about it. I mean, the Nazis tried to hide this, right? The new fascists, like, for instance, like Orban, who says, are you ready for this? He says, I want a society that doesn't have mixed blood, mixed races. He says this. And the American press, I mean, simply ignores the implications of this. What does it mean when you say you don't want a society with mixed races? What's the end point of that? Where does that go? What does that say about the logic of extermination? But the final point here, the new fascism is Christofascism. It's Christofascism. It's a merging of the old fascism built on racial purity and cleansing with another kind of fascism built on the extermination of anyone who is not a white Christian nationalist. This is truly frightening, frightening. And it seems to me if young people want to have a future, they had better understand that we are in a moment that Gramsci talked about. He said, between the old and the new, a new moment is emerging with new cultural apparatuses, new social formations, new political, a new understanding of politics, a new way in which power is being concentrated. Power today is global. Politics is local. Global power controls local politics. I mean, when the international banking movement during the recession, it said, hey, look, you know, we're going to take money out of Greek accounts because they got to pay back their debts. They intervened literally and took away people's money. If something in some way violates what they call their global exchanges around the environment, you say, look, there's poison in the gas, as Canada made a claim to be doing at one point and wanted to in some way prevent that chemical ingredient be putting in the gas itself. They protested to the International Monetary Fund and they overruled them. So we really have to understand these two different configurations, one around power, but the other around cultural apparatuses. C. Wright Mills got it right. He said, "There's the winds of change have to be understood and that the most important modes of domination today," Bourdieu said the same thing, "is now in the cultural apparatuses. These have become teaching machines. They don't just create subjects, they subject subjects to power. They organize identities. We are witnessing with that press that we talked about, Dick and Sharon, that I in the piece I sent you, a massive form of normalization. And that normalization, which normalizes Trump, as Dick was saying, right? It normalizes Trump. Nobody says this is an election between a fascist, an outright fascist, right? And a neoliberal. They say, oh, they're just two points of view. They're not two points of view at all. I mean, what they do is they take politics out of the reporting and they normalize the depoliticization that they're doing to what I call a cesspool of common sense and balance and objectivity. I can't stand that word. I mean, it's just a retreat from everything that matters. Who says that they believe in nothing anymore? That there are just opinions flying around and they all have the same consequences, you know? I mean, but this is the position that they take. And they do it with an arrogance that only comes with power, right?
That's right.
So winds of change. and the wind is blowing hard one direction. I would say it's the Powell memo come into full blossom. The right has captured education. They've captured think tanks. They've captured money. You have to be rich even to go to college anymore. And it's nice that you compliment LA Progressive. I think the things that you say appear on our pages, on Counterpunch, on Truth Out, on Truth Dig. But it seems like we're talking to a small audience compared to the wash of mainstream media. What can get the wind blowing the other direction?
I think there are a couple of things. I mean, first of all, you want to begin with the assumption that power is never exclusively about domination. Sorry, it doesn't work that way. You know, I think the second thing is to recognize that we're in the midst of a legitimation crisis that's massive, massive. The system can't defend itself anymore. All it can do is mobilize anguish and hatred. And these things don't keep a society together. Thirdly, it seems to me, I think we vastly underestimate a number of movements that have emerged in the last 10 years that are far more significant in terms of changing young people's consciousness, because the future of resistance is with young people. I really believe that. It's with young people. They don't buy this crap. You know, many of them at all, you know, they're not joining Nazi leagues for, you know, a new nation, right? The RNC, the Republican National Committee, they get all their young people from religious schools. You know, they all come out of those wacky sort of fundamentalist Oral Roberts spaces. So it seems to me that, you know, the modes of opposition have expanded dramatically around modes of domination and how they need to be fought, ecological, gun violence, the attacks on free speech, the banning of books, trans people. The only problem is they've got to unite. And of course, not to mention the working class resistance that's emerged with these new unions. This is all very fruitful to me. I mean, I remember talking to George Lukács' secretary, and I said, how do you do this? You know, I was a young guy in Boston University about to be fired. And I said, how do you do this? Should I plant seeds? And I know there's a sense of urgency, but I don't think we want to fall into the trap of believing that the White House has to be stormed tomorrow in the interest of resistance. I think that these alternative organizations have to be built. The media, like LA Progressive, has to be expanded. Young people have to learn how to be cultural producers and not just cultural critics. The question of agency has to become fundamental to politics. Agency, who has it? Who takes it away? What are the largest systemic forces at work that promote this? Why is education now so fundamental to the struggle for politics? What does it mean to talk about civic literacy? What does it mean to talk about pedagogies of the oppressed? What does it mean to suggest that all these institutions that we're operating in which public spaces have been destroyed, need to be recovered, but in alternative ways with a different sense of imagining the future? And all we need to do is to see those elements come together in a mass, multiracial working class movement. If that can be done, it seems to me there's more hope than we can imagine. Hope may be a bit dysfunctional right now, but it's not lost. It's never lost. And it seems to me that what we need to talk about is educated hope. A hope that's militant and educated and brings these groups together. I'm not sure. Trump may win this election, you know, and that will put the United States into a period, if not the globe itself, of massive repression. There's an old left line that says objective conditions will determine. I think it's bullshit. I don't believe that, you know, that the objective conditions will automatically guarantee a political outcome for the left. They'll mobilize and so forth and so on. I think the hard work, whether it's Trump or Biden, is we've got to collapse. We've got to get rid of this two-party system. We need an alternative. We need a socialist party. We need a socialist party that's not based nationally, but is based internationally. The struggle is international. It's not just national. The great thing about young people that I see is that kids from the Black Lives Movement, I say that because I'm older, you know, I mean, they're international. They cross borders. These kids are border crossers. Think about what happened with the encampments. It went all over the world. I mean, it wasn't just at Columbia. It wasn't just, you know, at the University of California in Berkeley. I mean, it was everywhere. stuff is not going to stop, because the suffering is not going to stop, because the inequalities are not going to stop, because the ideological normalization and repression is not going to stop. And so it seems to me in those moments, I see hope as opposed to despair. And I also think that despair is always on the side of complicity. I don't care if it's a weak despair or if it's a hard line despair. Cynicism is complicity. There's no room. Resistance is not an option anymore. It's a necessity.
That's absolutely.
That's a different moment that the civil rights movement of the 50s and 60s, they got that. That moment has to be resuscitated. This is a time of incredible urgency, and the stakes are enormous. And the Palestinian struggle is the most powerful symptom of that at the moment.
Absolutely. And you know, there are times when I do feel despair, but all I have to do is really think about the children, my children, yeah, and other people's children. And then there's really no alternative. We have
that's exactly how I feel. I mean, I just wrote a piece that's going to be in a new book called The Burden of Conscience, which I'm going to have you write. I talked to Dick about this already. We'll publish the introduction, you know. But I wrote Killing Children in Gaza. You want to really begin by having a symbol there that brings home what this all means? Talk about what's happening to kids. Talk about the fact that in this country, you know, the greatest threat of violence that young people face is from gun violence. More kids die from gun violence than from getting hit in cars. I mean, how much longer can this go on? Can they normalize this stuff in light of the very visceral suffering that we see all around us? The other side of this, look, and I don't know how you feel about this. One of the things that we see happening is that the social contract is all but dead, right? That's part of the new fascism. And what that means is that problems are now criminalized, social problems. Poverty is criminalized, homelessness is criminalized, social services become criminalized in many fundamental ways through surveillance. And when that happens, the social state collapses and the punishing state all of a sudden takes over a whole range of institutions,
right?
University campuses, public schools, social services, healthcare. How much longer can that go on without those contradictions becoming so overwhelming that a politics of passion, a politics that brings people together, reveals the illegitimacy of a system that is rooted without question in the most fundamentalist evils?
Absolutely. Well, you know, as a Black person, what you've just described has been our history.
Right,
so
exactly.
You were part of that social contract.
That's right.
You talk about the Black codes and things being made illegal, like loitering, being unemployed can get you put in prison. Well, we know all about that.
Well, and I think, Sharon, where that really comes home is that, you know, you get a lot of white scholars talking about fascism as if fascism began in Europe. It began with the KKK, began with slavery.
Right.
You know, I mean, I'm sorry, you want to talk about the first instance of fascism? It's the KKK. They're one of the first neo-Nazi organizations in the United States. And of course, Black writers like Du Bois and everybody else have been writing about this for years, and only now, in the midst when white society is being threatened by fascism, is that discourse beginning to emerge with R.D., with Robin, my friend Robin Kelly, and others who are really now writing about this stuff, you know?
That's right. Yeah. You know, so one of the taglines of the LA Progressive is the centrality of race. And Lonnie Guinea, the late, great Lonnie Guinea, wrote a piece, a book with a gentleman's name is Torres, the Miner's Canary, and using race as an indicator of the status of our democracy.
Right.
If we were to follow the direction of Lonnie Guinea, we could have been catching a whole lot of these problems that we're seeing right now. We should have nipped them in the bud years ago, because they've always been on full display in the Black community.
This is why, from my work, this question of remembering and historical memory is so crucial to any emancipatory project. I mean, this is a pedagogical tool that we just have to begin to understand and embrace. This is not an academic issue. I mean, this is a deeply political issue. You erase history and you erase the possibility for people to narrate themselves. You erase history and you erase the possibility of coming to grips with those problems that need to be acknowledged, corrected, and overcome. You erase history, and what you do is you put in place a narrative in which only the privileged can narrate themselves. And that's what we see happening in the public schools, right? I mean, DeSantis is like, you know, I mean, he was born in the wrong era. He should have been born in 19, he should have been a part of the those governments that operated either under Pinochet or the Nazis in 1933.
Well, this has been, it's hard to characterize this as a delightful conversation, but certainly enlightening. And you have given us reason for hope, because we do have reason for hope. We live on a planet of plenty. You know, we act as if there's scarcity, but we have the resources. Everything is available to us. The masses,
you know, look,
need to organize.
It seems to me, you know, the first mark of authoritarianism is to destroy the minds that would criticize. And so the question of critique becomes not something that we understand on the side of despair. Critique is like opening up a book or opening up a journal or watching a video, being involved in an image-based culture and seeing something that changes your life. It's the spark in the darkness. And so for me, you've got to have a language of critique, and you've got to have a language of possibility.
Right.
And I think that when one informs the other, then we don't say, oh, criticism, that's a negativity. We say criticism is part of the politics of hope.
Right.
Because it opens up the spaces that makes hope livable, possible, engaged, and enabled. You know, but I just want to qualify that, because I don't feel like I'm on the side of despair. I feel that I want to create a language that opens up new books, new chapters, new ways of understanding a system that basically hides the kinds of things that the LA Progressive, Truth Out, Counterpunch, a number of other groups really become the model for, you know, remember, we live in an ocular culture. This is an image-based culture. My generation, I'm older than both of you. That was a print-based culture. Oh yeah, I'm much older. I'm 80. That's a print-based culture. This is an ocular culture. And we have to recognize what literacy means in light of that change in the culture. You know, it demands a different politics, and it demands a different understanding of hope, different understanding of domination, and how subjects are created. And we need to tap into that. And I think that's what even a video like this, I mean, you know, to say, look, we publish print matter, and we you know, we operate off different levels of intervention around what it means to speak to people. Our voices are multiple, and our narratives cut across different kinds of ways to produce knowledge. I think that's really helpful.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today.
Yeah, this has been fabulous, and we look to repeat it again. So we're going to get this up as quickly as we can and get it out. This was a wonderful talk, and it was so nice to kind of meet you here, at least.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's so nice to actually see each other, isn't it? Huh?
Yeah.
And as I told Dick, if I come to the West Coast, I have to take you out to dinner.
Oh, we love that.
That would be wonderful.
My wife is Greek, and she absolutely wants to go to the West Coast, and she loves the fact that I'm writing for the LA Progressive.
Oh, wonderful! Great. Oh, cool. Well, let us know when you're in town.
Okay, I will. All right.
So thankful that you joined us, and we're looking forward to many conversations in the future.
I just want to say one last thing. I want to say how grateful I am that both of you are around to be able to publish this kind of work for myself and others. You do a great service to anything that speaks of the struggle for economic and political justice, and you should be called out for that.
Thank you.
That is real hard, important political work. And as one of your authors, I just want to say I'm honored and I'm thankful.
Wow.
Thank you so much. We really
Thank
appreciate
you,
it. All righty.
Okay.
Have a wonderful
Bye-bye.
Day. So long.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.